Welcome to Frank Buckley Interviews. My guest tonight, the longtime executive producer of the monster TV hit, American Idol. He's also the creator of So You Think You Can Dance. My guest, Nigel Lythgoe.
Frank Buckley Interviews starts now.
He's enjoyed huge success as a producer and creator of global TV hits. But Nigel Lythgoe has never forgotten where he came from, humble beginnings in Northwest England.
The whole reason for doing dance and performing, if you will, is we had a pier at the end of New Brighton Pier, and they used to have a talent competition there, which I used to go and sing, and used to get a crate of Coca-Cola. I mean, 12 bottles of Coca-Cola.
More with Nigel Lythgoe and his son, Kris, who will join us to tell us about a British holiday tradition called Panto that they've brought to America, live stage performances for the entire family. More with the Lythgoes when we come back. Nigel, welcome to Frank Buckley Interviews.
Thank you very much, Frank.
I'm looking forward to speaking to you about producing American Idol at the height of its popularity, about creating So You Think You Can Dance, about the panto that you're producing with your son. We're going to ask your son to come in and talk to us about that and how people can see that everywhere. But first, I want to take you back to Wallasey, England.
Yes.
And at the age of 10, I've read, you announce to George and Gertrude, your parents, that you are interested in becoming a dancer. And your father is a dock worker.
That's right.
And I assume that in the northwest of England, that's not sort of the classic ambition
there
of a working class.
There weren't that many tap dancing dockers. That really weren't. But I was 11, Frank,
11.
Just to put the record straight. And I'd just seen, I think, Sammy Davis Jr. in a movie called Robin and the Seven Hoods. And he did this incredible tap dance on a bar while shooting a machine gun. And I thought, that's for me. and I think we had enough money in those days to either send me to piano lessons, which I would have loved, or to tap dance lessons. And I come from a very sort of humble background. We had cobblestones in our backyard, an outside toilet. And I used to tap dance on the cobblestones. In Northern England, it was they used to do it with clogs and nails in the clogs. It used to be called sparking, because as you hit your clogs, it threw off sparks. And I really enjoyed it. My dad was very supportive. It wasn't like a Billy Elliot. I was supported by both parents. And I became good at tap dancing.
And it is said that you were diligent, and that you've had this work ethic, even going back to that young age. And I did my research, and in the Liverpool Echo.
Oh my God, Frank.
Hilda Bromley,
yes,
the proprietor of the Hilton Bromley School of Dance and Drama,
yeah,
said about you, Miss Hilda said, he was a very busy boy, always working, very impatient. He was a very go-ahead young person.
Wow.
True?
I've never heard that before. I used to have other jobs as well, going to school. I had a paper round very early on, delivering papers, freezing cold. And after school, I was delivering fruit. So yeah, and then I was rushing off to dance class. So yeah, I guess I was very busy.
And what was driving you at that young age? Was it, I want to make money, or I want to make enough money to be able to dance, or?
The whole reason for doing dance and performing, if you will, is we had a pier at the end of New Brighton Pier. There was a huge ballroom where the Beatles would appear, and a pier that went out into between the Mersey and the Irish Sea. And they used to have a talent competition there, which I used to go and sing, and used to get a crate of Coca-Cola. I mean, 12 bottles of Coca-Cola. Well worth it, you know.
Yeah,
you could
yeah.
sell them for threepence to your mates. And that, I liked the applause. And I liked the spotlight, if you will. It was sort of craving attention.
Yeah. Do you remember the first time?
Yeah, I sang Neil Sedaka's Hey Little Devil. And I got through to the finals. And a young lady beat me who did a song and a tap dance. which, and again, pushed me into tap dancing. Unfortunately, and this is totally true, Frank, the following year, I went back and did a song and a tap dance. The same girl came back, did a song, a tap dance, and had a ventriloquist's doll. And she beat me again. Now, I never went into ventriloquism, but it was inspiring to sort of say, you know, gave you a nice little kick.
Yeah. And so I wonder, given that experience as a young person coming up as a dancer and as a singer, when you started creating these talent shows, these spectaculars that people, these gigantic TV shows, and you look across the stage at some young person, and they're looking across at you when you were Nasty Nigel in England.
Yes.
And all of their hopes and dreams are riding on that moment.
Yeah.
Do you think back to that moment of yours as a child at all, or are you? Can you divorce yourself from that and just look at someone?
Yeah. No. I totally divorce myself from that, and you have to. You can't really relate. Too much. You can only relate to the other talent that they are against. Mm. That's what you must do. And look at it from the audience's point of view. And as far as that little Nasty Nigel label that I got, I wasn't actually being that nasty. Mm. I was using, we had two wonderful comedians called Morecambe and Wise, and they did a sketch with Andre Previn. And Eric Morecambe said to him, well, you played all the right notes, but I think you put them in the wrong order. And I said the same thing to the kids. You know, you sang all the right notes, but you put them in the wrong order.
Right.
Oh, Nasty Nigel. And I got it as well because I said to some young lady, Christmas is gone and the goose is still fat. Oh, you use that word fat, and oh my God. And we have so many national newspapers, unlike America, and every one of them had this quote in, and Nasty Nigel said this.
Oh.
It made the television show, I have to say. You know, everyone wanted to watch the show then. It was a huge success.
Right. And I wonder, when you were creating American Idol in this country, and producing it, and you cast Simon in the role of one of the judges, was that sort of an archetype that you thought about?
Or we did. Yeah. I knew we always needed a nasty one, if you will.
Yeah.
And when I say nasty, honest is a better word, I think.
Yeah.
Because a lot of British shows and American shows of talent orientated would always smooth over a tough criticism. So it was, well, your voice wasn't quite right, but you're wearing a beautiful dress.
Right.
Or doesn't your hair look nice like that?
Right.
So I needed someone to say, it's not good enough. This is a tough business.
Yeah.
And, you know, I don't think you're going to make it.
Mm.
Look at doing something else with your life, because dreams can turn into nightmares if you pursue a road that is not going to work out for you.
And so in that moment, when you see the person break down, and I suspect you've had moments like that in just private auditions and away from the glare of cameras and lights, do you want to sort of reach across and pat them on the back, or is it a business? And
it's never normally outside of the cameras, and it is part of the business, and I like showing it. You know, it is tough.
Yeah.
And, you know, there are artists out there that are household names that can still break down and be upset.
Mm.
And that is the life of this business.
Yeah.
And in dance terms, it's a very short life. Very short.
Yeah.
But Simon Cowell was already established in my head through Pop Idol, because we originally did Pop Idol in England.
Right.
I did Pop Stars first with Nasty Nigel, and that got transferred into Pop Idol. And Simon stepped into the shoes there and found the role very easy.
When you created American Idol here...
Well, I didn't create it, I exec produced it.
Yeah. Well, you executive produced
it. The concept came from Simon Fuller.
Right.
Yeah.
But you were running the show. You were the executive producer.
Yeah.
And did you guys know that it was going to be as big as it became?
The answer is very simply no, but we thought it would be successful without question. When Fox agreed, because ABC wouldn't even take the pitch meeting, other channels turned it down, and Fox through Rupert Murdoch speaking to his daughter because he was watching the success of it in England, said, is this a good show? And I believe, and she told me, Elizabeth told me, that she said, yes, but you must take the judge Simon Cowell with it, because that's the British honesty. And I wouldn't suggest you Americanize it. Mm. Just leave it as is, because the Brits can get away with being rude. Which I thought, oh, great, fine. It's helped me for a long time
right,
now.
Right. And then you move on to So You Think You Can Dance.
Yeah.
And you create that.
Yeah.
And that was really in your original wheelhouse.
Well, you know, I'd given up dancing and choreography at about 40 years old. I was invited out here to America when I was 50. So it was a total change of life for me. And Simon Fuller, who created American Idol, said, look, we've done really well with singing. You started as a dancer. Why don't we do the same with dancing? I said, it'll never work. There aren't any dancing programs. Dancing with the Stars wasn't here. Nothing was here.
You said it wouldn't work.
Yeah. Listen, I said American Idol wouldn't work, so don't listen to me. When I say something won't work, it's going to be huge. And I must have left it about 6 months, and he kept on at me and kept on at me. You've got to be able to find something that is going to work. And I said, well, I'll go away and think about it, and came back with the concept of So You Think You Can Dance, which was based on, I had so many people tell me they were dancers, and I said, oh, do you do ballroom? Oh, don't do ballroom. Do you tap? Oh, no, I can't tap. Did you start with ballet? Oh, no. What do you do? And so I thought, I was trained in so many different styles that I thought, well, if you're going to say you're a dancer, I'd like you doing more than one style of dance. Mm. So it was never a question, so you think you can dance. It was always, so you think you can dance, eh? It was that, then do this and do that.
Right.
And I think that's been the strength of it. And over the years, the standard, Frank, it's really gone from here up to there, yeah. You know? And mixing the street kids with the formerly trained kids has created an incredible dancer now.
You've had so much success, and as part of it, you've also spent a lot of time giving back. And you've been recognized for it, and in England, you received an OBE, honored, chosen by the cabinet, honored by the royal family. You go to Windsor Castle to receive this, and I just wonder, as if you had a moment to reflect when you were doing it, as this boy who grew up in Wallasey, the son of a dock worker, to be in Windsor Castle, to be having a conversation with the future heir. The heir to the throne. What was that like?
Stunning. And one of those things that when you get the phone call, we would like to honor you with the Order of the British Empire. Are you willing to accept it? And you, yes! and you're not allowed to tell anybody for about 6 months.
Oh.
So, you know, it's just one of those things boiling up in you all the time. So it was great to actually release it. I wish my parents had been alive. Mm. And I know they were always proud of me, but that would have been special, I think. But, you know, I had produced, I started off as a dancer on the Royal Variety Performance in England, became a choreographer and choreographed it, became a director and directed it, produced it. And I used to walk the Queen down the line and introduce her to. So I can't say I know the royal family, but I've been in their presence for many, many years. So it wasn't so much that. It was walking into Windsor Castle with my two sons and one grandson. It was just, it took your breath away.
You're now bringing your producing power to the Lythgoe Family Panto.
Yes.
And I want to bring Kris in to help us.
He's the brains behind it all, by the way.
Excellent.
I'm just there to support. He is the brains behind it.
So we've brought the brains in.
Yeah.
Kris, thanks for joining us.
We needed to do that, Frank.
Not sure about that.
Kris, tell us, I think a lot of people in this country still don't know what panto is. So first tell us what it is.
I mean, in essence, it's musical theatre, but it's musical theatre with a few added extra facets like interactivity. But it's definitely geared towards the family. So it's songs that are pop songs from the 50s for the grandparents, the 80s for the parents, and then today's, you know, Bruno Mars and Meghan Trainor for the kids. But it really is, in essence, it's musical theatre with interactive, so you get to boo the bad guy and cheer for, you know, the good girl and things like that.
Yeah, my wife, who grew up in England, was telling me that the characters will speak directly to the audience and say, so-and-so isn't here, and the audience will yell, yes, he is, or
absolutely.
That sort of thing.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, and it's geared so the way we write, or the way I write the script, is so that we really kind of hold the hand of the audience. So they get it straight away. I mean, you know, a lot of folks back in the UK were questioning whether American audiences would get the concept, but they get it. I mean, you know, it's a little bit like a sports kind of vaudeville kind of element where, you know, the audience get to shout out and things like that. Right. But
and the kids love it. And it's the one place they can shout out, you know, and with their parents. I think the first season you did it, it was a little strange because there's a ghost gag where the ghost gets behind the character and the character goes like this and the ghost does it and there's nobody there and then the other way. And in England, you know, you shout out, behind you!
Right.
So we had a couple of plants in the audience and shouted out, behind you! And the entire audience looked behind. Not you. So now, of course, right. Kris sets it up really well so everyone knows what's going on.
Yeah. And you use some iconic characters in your panto. Who is it this year?
I mean, so this year we're doing our take on The Wizard of Oz, and we're calling it The Winter of Oz. But they always are based on fairy tales because the key for us is to get these kids into the arts. So what we do is we pick a story the kids already know, couple them with the songs they already know, and then throw that interactive element in and really get them gripped to their seats. So, you know, we've done Cinderella, we've done Snow White, Peter Pan, Aladdin. So all these great fairy tales that are hundreds, I think Aladdin's 1,000 years old or something, we get to use, and then, like I said, put this pop element in for the kids. Yeah. So
the original Disney films all use these Grimm's fairy tales and the Hans Christian Andersen stuff, you know? But for the kids, I find what's so great about it, and watching Kris's shows, is because they are so involved in it, they feel comfortable going into a theater, which can only be good for their future.
Yeah.
And it's great for them to be in a group of people socially and feel like they are having the same emotions as other kids.
Yeah.
So it takes them out of their shells, gets them away from the television and video games. It's a wonderful thing for families and especially the kids.
And I would imagine for a lot of these kids and families even, it's the first time they've gone to that sort of musical theater venue.
And that's what, again, we're trying to do. As Dad says, you know, with the iPad, I know my son's addicted to Fortnite. It's all sort of rage and everything. It's really trying to get these families to come together and experience something. Because for now, especially in the time that we live in with Netflix and these great streaming services, you know, I can watch a program, my wife Becky can watch a program and at separate times, you know. So we have this separation in our families going on consistently now that with these shows we really can bring that family back together again. And what better way than introducing, you know, kids to theatre for the first time?
Right. Yeah. So you used to watch television together. That's what was so good about American Idol. It was a packed show, so your entire family came together. And years ago, there was only one television in the home, so everyone wanted to watch that. Yeah. With the proliferation of televisions all over the house now, Kris is right, the whole family is dissected and everywhere.
Yeah, I feel like in general, we don't have communal experiences.
That's right, yeah.
Right?
But, you know, that's exactly what we're trying to do is unite that family together and have that experience where the grandmother can like one element. So although it's fairy tales, they're in fact written for adults. So the adult jokes are in there. We do a lot of local jokes.
You write the book?
Yes.
Yeah.
I do. Yeah,
that's
spend
a lot
half
of pressure, isn't it?
It is. I mean, you know, especially when you have four shows going on, you know, we're all over the country, so I had to write four scripts this year, which wow. I mean, it's
every time I insult him, he writes it down and uses it in a panto.
It's true. Well, let me ask you about that. I'll pick up on that point. Growing up with this guy and having one of the most famous and successful producers in the world.
Did you heard that? You heard him
yeah,
say that.
I've heard a few times.
Is your father.
Yeah, but I've been telling you. You're hearing it from someone else.
And it's your family business. Do you feel a pressure? Is it a good thing, a bad thing?
I think it's a bit of both. You know, I think it's, you know, what great opportunity I've been able to have because of his success, and not just his success, but his hard work. You know, he has a hard work ethic that, without question, as a child, you see that where he's just nonstop working to achieve his goals and his dreams. Yeah. So to have that influence in your life is certainly helps me along my way.
Finally, if people go to the Panto in Laguna or in Pasadena, give them a sense of what to expect. What are the shows?
If you go there once, it really will be a holiday tradition for your family, for the probably the foreseeable future. We have people, we've been here now for 10 years in Los Angeles, and we have people that come back every year. And the reason simply is every single show has that holiday twist, so we get the family into the holiday mood. But it's that uniting of the family. I can't stress that even more, you know, to be able to take your parents and your child to the same show, and they get different elements out of that show, is you know, a Christmas or Hanukkah present there and then. You know, it really is a magnificent feeling to be able to go and spend that with your family.
Was it 3 or 4 years ago that you had a princess?
Yeah, you know, we've had Ariana Grande was our Snow White,
which is
and she was magnificent all the way through. She really was. It's really great to see this talent come together. And put on a great show for the families. And it's families producing shows, entertainment shows, for families. So it's a lot of fun.
Well, congratulations to this father and son duo.
Thank you.
I wish you well, and I hope people will come see the show.
Thank you. And this was another thing, just to add, that he said wouldn't work. So whenever he does say this won't work, it works.
It's true. Excellent. Your program, Frank, is going to work.
Oh, no, don't say that. Don't. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
My thanks again to Nigel and Kris Lythgoe for a terrific conversation. If you'd like to hear the entire uncut version of our conversation, check out the Frank Buckley Interviews podcast. It's available at Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen to podcasts, including the KTLA News app. Thanks for your feedback on social media. I'm Frank Buckley TV on Twitter and on Instagram, and there's a Frank Buckley Facebook page as well. I read all of your comments, and I post updates and extra content on those channels. And you can see this entire broadcast on demand on YouTube. Just search for Frank Buckley Interviews, Nigel Lythgoe. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.